God worthy. Praise God, oh my soul, as the blessings flow, praise God, oh my soul, when it seems they don't, still we sing this song, praise God. Even in the perfect storm, I'll thank you for your perfect love. And even in the worst of times, when worship is a sacrifice, you're never not worthy. Oh, you're never not worthy. Forever you're worthy, oh, forever you're worthy. Praise God, oh my soul, as the blessings flow, praise God, oh my soul, when it seems they gone. Still we sing this song, praise God, oh my soul, as the blessings flow, praise God, oh my soul, when it seems they gone, still we sing this song, praise God. Doesn't go my way, I'm still going your way. When it's life, doesn't go my way, I'm still going your way. When it's life, doesn't go my way, I'm still going your way. As the blessings flow, praise God, oh my soul, when it seems they gone, still we sing this song, praise God, oh my soul, as the blessings flow, praise God, oh my soul. Still sing this song, praise God, praise God,
ever you're worthy, Lord. Praise God. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise even when it seems they don't. Praise mountains high or valley low. Praise Father, Son, and Holy
You were the one. What? beautiful name it is. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a beautiful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
The name of Jesus.
Heavenly Father, this morning we just come before your presence, and Lord, we say you're worthy. You're worthy. Thank you, Lord, for the price that you paid. Thank you, Lord, for being humble even to death, the death of the cross. That through that price you paid, now we have a name that becomes our strong tower, Lord. We have a name we can call, Lord. We have a name that the blood has given us access to, and we can be called your son, Father. And with a grateful heart, with a humble heart, this morning we're just saying, Jesus, you're worthy.
Amen.
To receive all the glory, all the honor, all adoration. Thank you, Jesus. Well, in Jesus' most wonderful and marvelous name we've worshipped. Amen. 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 Hallelujah.
Morning, everybody. Shem, do you want to come sit there? We have space. You're keeping the door watch, okay. We now have official door watchers sitting there. So welcome to church, everybody. It's so nice to see you all this morning here. I'm going to lead us into, I'm going to give you the opportunity to give unto the Lord this morning. When we do that, that's how we see God's kingdom grow. I'm going to ask the ushers just to pass through the baskets. We do have a full program this morning, so I'm going to be quick. Hebrews 13, verse 15 to 16 says, "Therefore, by him, let us continually offer the sacrifice of praise to God, that is, the fruit of our lips, giving thanks to his name. But do not forget to do good and to share, for with such sacrifices, God is well pleased." So it says we should continuously offer our praise and our thanksgiving unto God. But that's not the only sacrifice that he is pleased with. We should also continually do good and share with others, as that also pleases God. So while the baskets are going through, if you didn't bring any cash and you still want to give, we do have an internet bank details, it's there. So if you want to do an EFT transfer, you can just take an image or a picture, or you can just ask me afterwards for the details and I will send it to you. But let's pray over the offerings. Father God, we come before you with hearts full of gratitude and reverence as we are gathered here today. Lord, we thank you for the abundant blessings you have poured out upon us. You have provided for our needs and showered us with your grace and your mercy. Today, as we give a portion of what you have entrusted to us, we do so with joyful hearts and generosity. Lord, we pray that these offerings would be used for your glory and to further your kingdom here on this island. May it bring hope to the broken, comfort to the weary, healing to the hurt, and may it be a blessing to those in need. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. So for the new people on the island, today is not Mother's Day here, but it is an essay. So if you have a mom there, happy Mother's Day to them. Dad, if you didn't know, in 2 weeks it's Mother's Day, so you are warned. 2 weeks, Mother's Day, yeah, okay. So I just want to see who is joining me in the Encourage Your Husband Challenge. Just put up your hands. Okay, so for those husbands, do you feel encouraged yet? No, we're only halfway. So we are only halfway. We still have time to encourage you. So, if you know what this is and you know how to operate it, please come and help us at the beach break. Please come and sign up. We need some people to help us, like turn the sausages around, batter the bread, and. So if you want to come and help us, we have a beach break. 27 May. It will be at Montswazi Beach. Now I'm going to get you excited. Free food, everybody. Yeah, so the church will be providing the food. You just need to bring your own drinks and your chair. That's all. And your hands to help. So please come and join us. We have little forms. Yes, Dr. Ian?
Yeah, vegetarian.
We can make a plan. We make a plan for the veg people. So we have little forms there. If you haven't put your name up yet, just put your name and how many people is coming. We just want to know for catering purposes how many people to cater for. And then if you want to like make a salad or bring a cake or whatever, come speak to me or to Joyce. You are allowed to do that. We're always open for cake and stuff. So yeah, so it's going to be great fun. We have activities for the kids. We have activities for the adults, except drying, other activities. Pastor Rian is going to lead them, though. So, going to play rugby, yeah. So that's it for the beach drive. So remember that. And then we don't have any prayer meeting this week in church on Tuesday, no prayer meeting. And then the home groups, we still have the one Wednesday in church for French people. And then the one in Peribe, also on a Wednesday night. It's at my house. If you want to join us, come speak to me. Cheryl's home group in Montswazi, they are taking a little break while her kids are here to visit her. But if you want to join still, just speak to me. I'll put you into contact with Cheryl. I think that's it from my side. Now I have some sad news. The beautiful lady, Emanuela, please come up. So she just led this last song, What a Beautiful Name. She is leaving us. She's going back to her home country. We will miss you, especially in that song. We will miss your voice. Come stand here. So I'm going to ask the worship team to come up, because you're part of them. But some happy news in your life, not in mine, but because you are leaving. But it's her birthday tomorrow. Yeah. So I'm going to ask the worship team to lead that, because I can't sing.
We'll sing it together. One, two. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Emanuela. Happy birthday to you.
I'm going to ask Pastor Rian and Jocelyn and Marlies and Mary Vaughn to come up and just pray for her.
Amen. Firstly, we want to just say thank you to Emanuela for everything you've done for us. On the praise and worship team, we really appreciate you. And I have a strong sense in my heart this is not a final goodbye anyway. So I'm sure we're going to see you again. Father, we just pray and we just want to thank you, Father, for the privilege we had to have Emanuela in our team. We pray, Lord, that this time that she spent with us, that it would have been a time for her also of growth, a time that she learned more and more of you and more of your spirit. But Father, our prayer is now that as she goes back to her home country, that you will make her way straight. We pray for unfair favor to rest on her life, Lord. We pray, Father, that when people see her, that it will be in the days of like Jesus, when people saw the disciples, that they say that they could have seen that she was with Jesus. Father, I pray that Jesus will be seen all over her. I pray for your richest blessing to rest heavily on her. Whatever she does in these following months, Father, I pray for your guidance. I pray for your blessing. I pray for you to show yourself strong on her behalf, Father, that she will be a witness wherever she will go, Father. I thank you, Lord, that I know our paths will cross again, that you will bring us safely back at some time when the time is right. We submit to your time because we know your time is always perfect, Father. So I pray, Lord, that as she travels now, that you will keep her safe, that you will bless her. We pray for her family, Father. We pray for health. We pray for prosperity. We pray for your blessing. We pray for your favor to also rest on them, and that she would be a blessing in that family. And we honor you for that in the name of Jesus. Amen. 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 Thank you.
I'm going to invite Pauline to the stage. Pauline is from CEF, and she will tell you what it stands for. And we've known Pauline for quite a while in this church. So welcome, Pauline.
Thank you so much. So good morning, everyone. Just want to thank Pastor Rian and every team members for welcoming us today. And in fact, while I prepare something else as introduction, then I heard Pastor Rian saying like, Huemore? Is it Huemore? So I this bring me back to when the time when some of the African people would come from Eureka, from the Rieka to Mauritius. So they were teaching me. I didn't know how to speak African. So they would tell me, Huemore. Then I say, Baya donkey. This I know. Okay? And then they tell me, you know, when the leader will be coming, then you just, because this is very linked to the thing that I wanted to say. So they were telling me that all the, because there was about 12 teens coming to Mauritius doing short-term mission trip from that church. So they tell me, when you see that leader coming, you just tell her, you are just a demakar. So I was thinking, and they were telling me that this means she's so beautiful. So when Anne-Marie was coming, the leader, and then I was so happy. I was saying, I learned an African word. And she said, what is that word? I said, they were teaching me it. And then I said, you are such a dear Macar. And then she looked at me. And I said, oh, I said something wrong. But you see, when you don't know the meaning, because I was so empty, I didn't know what does it mean. Whatever people tell me, and then I just grabbed it. So I believe that young people were like that. They're seeking the truth, but they don't know where to seek it, and whatever people are telling it or telling them, or even what the world is giving them, they will take it. That's why the proverb says, an African proverb, a child is what you put into him. Whatever you put into him, that's what he will become. And what CF is doing, Child Evangelism Fellowship, mainly with the evangelization of children and discipleship, this is what we want to give them. And next slide, sorry. Philippians 4 verse 8. Finally, brothers, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, what is lovely, commendable, if there is any excellence, if there is any worthy of praise, think about this thing. These are the qualities that CF... Oh, I didn't know there was... I'm so sorry. So these are all the virtues that we would like the young people would like to have. So I just want to thank you for being our partners so that we can go outside on the field to really reach out to these children and disciple them in the Word of God. So just want to give you some praise report and as well prayer report. Praise reports that thank you for praying. We are now in a new school. It's called... we are at Yahweh International. So they just started the school, and now we have like free classes over there. So keep on praying for us. There are many children who have some issues, and we need to really be one-to-one sometime with them. So we need to always send two people to go and serve over there. And then as well, during the Easter time, we had a project called One Track, One Chocolate, because we believe that if we give chocolate together with a track, it works better. So the school will let us in, no matter what school. So we praise the Lord. We have been able to distribute 1,257 tracts to children. And we pray that they will accept the Lord through the tracts as well. And then during the month of April, we did training with 15 participants. So we just praise the Lord that some of them are already serving on the field. And just next slide. Through that, two new Good News Club has opened. You will see over there, it's in the flock. We didn't have any club in that area. I think last time I said it. But God provided for someone to allow us to be in his house. And now we're serving over there. And also at Bovalo, there were two guys. There was two ladies who were serving but was not trained. And they get to the training. Now they can do the club on their own. So that is amazing. Our staff can move to other places. Next slide. And then this is a place where you will see at Bel Air. In fact, during the month of December, we did a Christmas party club. And then we were doing the outreaches on the road. And then out of nowhere, a lady came saying, "Oh, you're doing an amazing job. Would you like to have a place where you can do a club with the children?" Just like that. She was not a Christian. So we said yes. And then she bring us to the other places where there was a lot of bushes. You know, the wood was not good. So like in last month, went there to clean up the places. You see how it is now. And then while we were cleaning, like 2 weeks before, the people were coming and see. In fact, I don't know. Yann, how do you say baron de la drogue? Comment we say baron de la drug dealer, the main one. So in fact, the place where we are is the place where they hide the drugs. And we didn't know. And we were cleaning. And then why sweeping? Because I was brooming everywhere because we needed to replant the area. And then one of our staff, his husband is a contractor, was busy doing all the wood thing so that the concrete roof won't fall on us. So while we were cleaning, and then I saw those needle, you know? So I was saying to themselves, how come there's needle over there and pack up very well, and they hide it over there? So I throw it away, and then the guy tell us, what are you going to do here? So we were explaining. We didn't know that he was a drug dealer. And then, like, minutes after, we were cleaning. You see all the bushes? There was bushes all around. They were hiding the drugs at the back. Two of the boys, and we couldn't do anything. They run inside and then bring two buckets, white things inside, so we didn't say anything, right? But we asked for your prayer, and we just praise the Lord. You will see the next picture. We are doing the club now. So yesterday, we started the club, and we got five children who got born again yesterday. So just pray for us. We need chairs and table over there so that you see they're sitting downstairs. We clean everything up. But just pray because the place where it is just in the center of a sort of, like you say, squatter camp. I don't know how you say it. It's just in the middle. We can't go. Like yesterday, I needed to send a boy with them. They can't go on their own, like just a lady. So please pray for us as we go inside. There are things that will be changed because we're just, you will see, if you come and visit one day over there, they have camera at the other house because it is where they sell the drugs. We are just next to him. So we just ask the Lord to really help us. We don't know how God is going to make things happen, that he may come to know the Lord and things will change. So we just pray for that. Next slide. Also, God is really good. Every month now, every 2 months, we have the opportunity to stand for people at Winners to collect food stuff. And last time, we have been able to distribute to 25 families. But it's not easy always to stand for other people. Some people will say to you, are you going to eat all this food yourself? Or take it for yourself? You know, and then you will think, I'm just standing for others and they're telling me so many things, you know. But God is really good. And this is the campsite. Thank you for your support. We are at the final phase. We are now inside. Plumbing is finished. Now we're on the electrical side, so please pray for us as we get inside for furniture and everything. And we want to start the work maybe in August, even though it's not really complete, but to bring children and start something over there. And then we have been praying CF for a camp director. In fact, deep down my heart, I was praying for this guy. His name is Chris Philip, for 3 years. Every time I tell him, he said, no, I can't, this is not mine. Second year, no. Third year, I will think. So on the third year, I just praise the Lord. He's now our camp director, has been recruited. So God is really good. I just have to hand over some stuff to him, and then he's going to oversee the area. So please pray for him as well. It's not an easy job. Next slide, all the prayer requests. Please pray for us for more entries in school because we have written to the Ministry of Education due to the thing that just happened to the MITD, you know, the boys who was beaten by two boys at school, the videos went viral everywhere. So as soon as the video was out, we wrote to the Ministry of Education to tell them that, see if we can go to the holistic, they have a holistic class. We're trying to see if we can get there, but also to the Catholic school, if we can get into that school. So please pray for us. Really, we want to get into school where the children are, where the teens are. But who says getting into all these schools, we need workers. So Luke 10:2 say, call to the Lord, because the harvest is ripe. So please call to the Lord together with us so that we can get workers to serve. And then we'll be having our All Africa Conference in Botswana. And please pray because our regional director is leaving. So he's passing the baton to a younger one. But the younger one was national directors together with us. So it's not easy when there is a change of, leaders. But we just pray that every one of us will submit to him because he was once our colleague and no longer our colleagues now, but our boss. So, and also there is, in July, there'll be the National Directors Institute. This is a training for all the national directors. I went there in 2017, and now I got the privilege to be one among the facilitators, the one who'll be teaching, and I'm really honored for that. But just pray that really God can provide for everything, and the trip will be safe, and my family will be without me for 3 weeks. So that is a long time. Poor my husband. But... but he's good. So also we'll be having a fundraising event on the 29th July, if you can book it, a Saturday, where we'll be raising funds for the final phase for the building. So keep us in prayer. We just want to give you a big thank you, because without people giving, it's impossible for us to go out and serve on the field. So you are part of what we are achieving. So thank you so much. So I won't say you are Demaka. I would say, you're such a beautiful people, but I don't know how to say it in Afrikaans. How do we say that? Oh, no. But I would say, buy a donkey.
Be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Wherefore, take unto you the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand. Stand therefore, having your loins girt about with truth, and having on the breastplate of righteousness, and your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Above all, taking the shield of faith, wherewith ye shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked. And take the helmet of salvation, and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, and watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplication for all saints.
Let us pray together. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you as we break bread this morning that you will bless us. and that we will follow your leading and your guidance. I pray, Father, that you would be the speaker of this word to the hearts of your people. I know this series has been on my heart for a while, and I know it's important for your church to understand these facts, Lord. So I pray, Father, that you would guide me and lead me to speak only what you lay on my heart. And I thank you for that in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. I think often when we become children of God, we think that we get born again and then that's it. Now we're on this earth and we just wait for Jesus to come back and we hope we make it and we hope everything works out okay. And that's how we kind of live our lives. And as children of God, we do have the victory. When Jesus died on the cross, he paid a full price, he paid a complete price. So we have the victory. But that does not mean that we don't find ourselves sometimes in battles. Amen. If you've lived longer than 2 weeks, you probably would have faced some battle. Whether it's a health battle, whether it's a money battle, whether it's a whatever. At one stage, when I started my business in South Africa a number of years ago, I remember I was praying so much for money. I think God thought his name was money. I kind of started with money all the time. But we go through these battles. And then what happens is we get a lot of teaching going around saying that everything's going to be fine. You just, life, don't let anything throw you. You're in victory. You're prospering. And then we pray and things don't work out like that. And then what happens is we question God and we say, but you know, what's happening here? And if we just study the Word of God, we realize that God is saying, you're in a war. I want to tell you this morning that you were created in the image of God, and the devil and his demons hate God. So make no mistake, they hate you. The Bible teaches me that the evil one goes around, the devil goes around to kill, steal, and destroy. That's his agenda for your life. When he looks at you, he sees the image of God that you were created in and he's coming for you. Amen. Make no mistake. I know this is, might not be the kind of message that you have expected, but I promise you at the end of this series, it'll be a huge blessing to you to understand who you are in Christ and how we are suited up in Christ. I want to read the scripture to you out of Ephesians 6, verse 10 to 18. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of His might. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, stand. So we're going to go through the scripture. I'm going to finish now. I just want to say one thing. I'm just laying a foundation this morning. We're not going to get into the armor yet. I'm laying a foundation for you to understand why we need the armor of God. Amen. Stand therefore, having girded your waist with truth, having put on the breastplate of righteousness, and having shod your feet with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Above all, taking the shield of faith, with which you will be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked one. And take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, being watchful to this end with all perseverance and supplication for all the saints. Ephesians, like Colossians, was written while Paul found himself in prison in Rome. Most scholars believe this was written while he was imprisoned in Rome. So, looking at how vividly he explains the armor of God, this makes sense. So it makes sense because he would have seen this God outside of his cell every day. Whenever he was let out into the yard or however they did it, he would have seen these guards. So his idea of the armor that these Roman guards wore would have been very, very clear in his mind, because it would have been continuous, because he spent many years in prison. So we can understand that some of the stuff that Paul written in this book is interesting, because a lot of, we all just take it for fact that Paul wrote this book. But there are some scholars that say, no, Paul actually didn't write this book. Somebody wrote it in Paul's name. Because of some of the things that's focused on this book, that's not focused in some of the other books of Paul. But it's my feeling, and if you look at the books, and I've gone through the books and the epistles quite a bit, I do believe that Paul wrote this book. And what I love about this is that out of his circumstances, God is teaching him something. Isn't that often how God works with us? That out of our circumstances, God teaches us. God helps us. God guides us. Amen. Out of the circumstances we find ourselves in, our lessons come. It makes me think of an elderly lady that was in South Africa. And as she walked into her house, she walked into a burglar in the house. And all she remembered is, my pastor said we must pray scripture. And she couldn't remember a scripture. So all she said is, Acts 2.38, Acts 2.38. And the guy just froze and put his hands in the air. And when the police came there, they said to him, why did you freeze when she gave you scripture? He said, scripture? I thought she said she had an Acts in 2.38. Make no mistake, we're in a war. Amen. I'm going to go through a couple of verses, and like I say, we're not going to be long this morning. Firstly, Paul says, finally, my brethren. This word finally is talking about something. Sorry, it kicked back there. Finally, my brethren. What he's saying with the word finally is not just that this is the final thing I want to tell you. He's saying, please consider what I'm saying to you now as important. Pay close attention to what I'm going to say now. So there's something important that I want to leave with you. So please pay close attention. I drop Yeltari Connexi. Can you go? Is it on that slide? Okay. And then he says, we do not wrestle. This word wrestle is the word pale. My word. We're in a battle. It's the word pale. And it's not wrestle like we understand it. This is not WWE stuff or Jan Wilkins when he was still wrestling. The wrestling they did is real combat, real struggle with each other. And it always happened in a place called the palestra. The palestra was like what we would typically known today as a place where we go to watch a sports event. I forgot the word now, a stadium. But some of it was actually a place where they exercised, where they practiced, where they learned these things. But then they went into battle. And what they did in these areas, and they were also situated like our stadiums in main metropolitan areas, but what they did in these things is three things. They did wrestle, boxing, and then something they called pancration. The wrestling, like I said, wasn't like our wrestling. This wrestling was no rules. So if you could gouge someone's eye out for him not to see you coming, you could do that. If you could break all of their fingers, so you often see when you look at old readings from Roman times, you see pictures of where the guy bends the other guy's hand like this to break their fingers off. Literally to break. Because if you don't have a hand, you can't hit me. So you often see them breaking backs and breaking knees and absolutely just going for it. Because it was, if you could kill him in the ring, that would have made you a champion. So the wrestling is not like our wrestling. I remember my dad always took us to wrestling when we grew up. My dad loved sports, so he took us to rugby and wrestling matches and boxing matches. And I remember as a youngster watching, if you come from South Africa, you'll know Jan Wilkins. Jan Wilkins was a big guy. And he was the champion at that stage. And the crowd went nuts if Jan grabbed someone and he would pick the guy up above his head, literally, and then he would slam him on his knee, and you call it a backbreaker. These guys didn't practice it beforehand. They would literally break your back in the wrestling. And then they also did boxing. Again, very different. They would have a leather strap that they strap around their arm like this. I was looking for a photo, but I couldn't find a decent one. They would strap the leather around their arms till they got to their fists, and then they would have serrated nails on the knuckles that they strapped together. So that when you were boxing and I got in a good shot, it didn't just leave you with a blue mark. It would have taken literally pieces from your flesh out of you. Again, when you look at all the readings from Rome, you see it even on some of their pottery, where people were beaten so badly that some of their mouth was not even there anymore. There's one story that I read that one of the guys was hit so hard with the first shot that they broke all the teeth in his mouth. And instead of showing pain, he swallowed his teeth. I love that because I think sometimes as Christians, we go through stuff and we say, instead of showing something now, I'm just going to swallow and just go through this and just, Lord, just help me. But that's how it was. It was serious. And then when all of the champions from the wrestling and the boxing came together, they got involved in the pancration. Sorry. And this was just no rules. This is typically what you will see when you look at a movie like Gladiator, when all the guys come together in the ring and every guy's got a weapon and every weapon's got spikes on it and every sword and everything is bigger than the next one. No rules. You could do whatever you wanted to do to the other person as long as he didn't walk out of there alive. So when Paul wrote to the Ephesians, they understood what Paul was saying when he said, this, you are in a wrestling match. This is not just a normal type of something we watch on TV. This battle you are in is a serious battle. This ring that you find yourself in with the devil is a serious thing. You have to understand that everything in your life is not just going to go well. You see Jesus walking around healing all that were sick. And often when he healed sick people, he would first cast out the devil. A lot of the bad stuff, not all sickness, don't get me wrong, but a lot of stuff in a lot of people's lives are because we open doors to the devil. And when you open a door to him, be assured he's going to come for you. Amen. We have to understand we're in a battle. When we stand up here and I ask you, pray for me, pray for Marlies, pray for the church, I'm not just asking you to be nice and pray for us. We are always under attack. We are having an impact on the island. We want to have an impact on the island. So we'll always, you as Christian, as child of God, will always be under attack. The devil does not want you to succeed. Amen, but I've got good news. Got good news, just hold on. John 10:10 says, the thief comes to steal, to kill, and to destroy. If you go to a war and everybody's in their war armor and you pitch up there in your shorts and slops, chances are you're not gonna make it. You have to be prepared when we go into war. I remember when I grew up, a lot of guys like Derek Prince and those guys were like big. So people in the church would do weird things. So one guy, I remember, taught people that if you get up in the morning, you will take the armor of God. So you will sit on the side of your bed and you will put on the helmet. And you will put on the shoes. And you'll put on your breastplate. And I think for your mind, that helps. But I was always looking at that and thinking, like, I'm not a genius or anything, but I'm clever enough to know that doesn't make sense. It's not a physical thing. This is a spiritual battle. Amen. So, I mean, if you want to put it on in the morning, you can do that. Don't get me wrong, but this is a spiritual thing. Amen. Then also in verse 12, he says that our wrestle against, we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against rulers of darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in heavenly places. I want to give you an idea of what that is before we're going to get into the good stuff next week. Firstly, principalities. The Greek word for that is arka. It's someone that holds a chief seat of power. It's a highest ranking general. So it's someone in a position of power. And then he says, against powers. Exousia, they receive license or authority from the ones above. That's what the Bible says there. Then there's rulers of darkness of this age. These are the warriors. These are the demons that go around. Cosmos Kartistos, raw power, focused, disciplined power. Then spiritual wickedness in heavenly places. Wickedness is the word malevolent. It's the word evil. Heavenly places, also, these same guys that taught me to sit on the side of my bed, and they also said, you must go to the highest buildings you can find because the principalities are up there. And then that's where you must spend your time and pray and break these principles. And I'm going to show you a couple of things as we go through this series. And the principalities are not always what we think they are. But actually, heavenly places, when you look at the meaning in Greek, it means the breath below the mountaintops. It's just here. It's around us. We are in a battle. Amen. We're nearly finished. Ephesians 6, verse 10 to 18 again. In verse 12, you see five times he says the word, we do not wrestle against, but against powers, against the rulers, against spiritual. And I was thinking, what does this word against mean? Because it comes, and you would think it's just against. But it's actually the word pros, and it means close, intimate. If you look at John 1:1, when he says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God. Again, pros. It's a closeness. Our battle is a close battle. It's close combat. It's not something afar off. It's not something that only I or the leadership do. It's something that we all need to be involved in. Amen. For the church, for your own life, for your family. Church, just think about what's going on in our lives today. Think about what's going on in the world today. The devil is against families. He's trying to break up the family system because he knows if he can do that, he can break up the church. He can break up schools. He can literally break us all. That's why today we have all these things about, I'm not sure if I'm a man or a woman or whatever. If you're not sure, you can come to me. Probably by looking at you, I'll be able to help. Amen. If there's something that I can't pick up, I'll teach you where to go and look. And then you can... Amen. Our pastor in South Africa always said, check your plumbing, then you'll know. Amen. Amen. But he's trying to attack. He's trying to break up the family system. People are walking around saying that, but we can't identify with God as a father, or we can't identify, or I am a man, but I want to identify as a... Guys, we're in a war. He's coming for the families. We have to understand that there are demons, they are the devil, these things are real. They're coming to break up society. As a church, as a Christian people, it's our responsibility to stand up and say, this will not happen. We'll armor up and we'll make sure that this will not happen. Amen. We are in a war, and it's close combat. And what I wanted to do this morning in my short introduction is show you that there is a war. There is a devil. There are demons. This fight is real. And this is why we need spiritual armor. This is not something you can fight on your own. Can I tell you, when you get really sick, and sometimes sickness are from the devil, sometimes it's just life, sometimes it's our own fault, whatever it might be. But if it's from the devil, if you are, you better be armored up to make sure you take the healing that God's given you. Amen. This is not something I just do on my own. As a church, we have to be in unity on this. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, stand. Having done all, to stand. I love this. He says, therefore. If you see the word therefore, you must look at why it's therefore. Therefore, in light of what I've just said, take up. Some versions say, take unto you. The King James says, take unto you. The full armor. That word, take up or take unto you, is analabete. What he's saying is take unto you, dress physically, but take it with urgency. Get into the fight with urgency. And then he says, the whole armor. Make sure that you are covered from head, from your mind, to your toes. The whole armor of God. This armor of the Roman soldiers used to weigh between 30 and 60 kilograms. Imagine I put 60 kilograms on you now and I tell you, go out and go and fight. Amen. 60 kilograms. But he says, take on the whole armor. And what I love about it is, I couldn't find a good photo, but the shield, some of their shields would be as big as they were. So when you join the army, they actually measured you. And especially for your shield, because your shield was supposed to cover you from top to bottom, from side to side. You see sometimes in the movies, if you like sword fight type things like me, you'll see that when these guys come together, all their shields block as one, and then the second row puts on top, and then the third row puts at the back. So they're like in a little cocoon. So these shields were supposed to be protection, not just for you, but for the guy next to you as well, when they got together. Romans 12:30. And what is the shield? It's the shield of faith. Romans 12:3. For I say, through the grace given to me, to everyone who is among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think soberly as God has dealt to each a measure of faith. You have enough faith. Like they were measured for their shield of faith, you were measured, and I want to tell you today, you have enough faith to go through whatever comes your way. Don't worry about my faith. Don't worry about the other guy's faith. God has given to each one the measure of faith that is needed in our lives. This is why Paul says, if you look at the heaviness of the thing and the measurement of all of the armor, this is why Paul says we have to be strong. If you're not strong, if you don't have might, you can never walk around with 60 kilograms on you the whole day. It's not possible. Paul understands that's also a heaviness from a spiritual point of view. When he talks about be strong, he's saying that you are endued with power. When we have the Holy Spirit in us, we are endued with that power already. We have the strength. We have the might. I love that word might. It's the word iskus, and it means a mighty, muscular man. Be strong in the Lord and in the power of His might. I wrote there that God is a mighty, muscular man. He was the first Mr. Universe, actually. It's in His strength. It's in His power. So what I want to leave with you this morning is that I want you to understand that there's a fight, that we're in it, but there's an armor that we're going to start looking at over the next few weeks that we put on from a faith perspective, from a spiritual perspective, to help us to stand and fight this fight. my last slide, and I really love this. He says, put on the whole armor, and like I said, we're in due. And then he says, having done all, stand. Now, I always thought he meant, well, if you've done everything, just stand. Let's see what happens. Because it sounds like that. Having done all, stand. But when I looked at this, what it actually means is that's God's vision of you at the end of the fight. How does God see me and you at the end of the fight? In victory. We conquer. I've read the end of this book. We win. So when God looks at this, he says, I see you standing in victory. The Bible teaches us that we are seated with him in heavenly places in victory. Although we go through battles, my dad used to say, we're going to go through battles, but no, we win the war. We'll go through battles, but we win the war. Amen. Other thing he says is, having brought everything to conclusion, you will stand. God is saying, when I look at everything, I'm not bound by time, I'm not bound by issues, I'm not bound by concerns. If I bring everything into conclusion, I see you standing. Maybe you're here this morning and you say, Rian, it feels like I can't stand under pressure. It feels like I can't stand under what's going on in my life. I want to tell you, God says this morning, he sees you standing. After all of this, in the conclusion of all of this, is you win. Amen. When we get into the armor of God, this is going to bless you. If you understand what we have in him to stand against these things. But I want you to understand there's a reason he's telling us to do this. God knows the end from the beginning. It's not a matter of when or if. It's going to happen. It's happened. It's done. Calvary was our victory. Amen. And that's my conclusion. See, I told you I'm not going to keep you long. Let's all stand together quickly. Father, we thank you for this word, and we understand that we are in a battle. But we thank you, Lord, that through your Holy Spirit we are equipped. Through your word we are equipped. We thank you, Father, that you have a plan for our lives, and that it's a plan of good and not evil. That you are for us. That you are for us. That you are for us, Lord. That you are not against us. Thank you, Father, that you go and make the way straight. Thank you that we walk in your victory. And whatever comes our way, we know you will never leave us, never forsake us. We thank you that nothing can tear us away from the love you have for us, Father. And we honor you for that in Jesus' name. Thank you, Father. Father, I pray this week that the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the unmerited, unearned, undeserved favor of Jesus Christ, the love of God and the communion of the Holy Spirit will be with each and everyone. And we honor you for that in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Thank you, everyone.